So good morning to all, and I'd like to ask Mr. Antonio Verde, Chairman of Supervisory Board of the Association for International Affairs, for his welcoming remarks. Thank you.
Your Excellency, dear guests, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the organizer of this conference, Association for International Affairs, I'm pleased to welcome you here. This conference is called Renewing Transatlantic Economic Ties Towards the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. The topic of the relationship between the United States and North America on one hand and Europe on the other is a long-term object of our focus. Current situation in transatlantic relations is heavily influenced by continuing economic stagnation and fears concerning the future of this unique political, security, and economic link. Project of TTIP presents a major opportunity to energize Euro-Atlantic community. The possibility of a new economic compact covering the European Union and members of the North America Free Trade Area has been actively discussed at both sides of the Atlantic Ocean. This is even more important in the Czech Republic, which has lately been focused on internal political disputes, and developments in international relations have been moved on second track. Therefore, we aim at using the topic of TTIP as means of boosting public debate about international politics in general, and specifically the role of the Czech Republic can play in the EU and transatlantic relations. I'm very proud that the Association for International Affairs is the first independent, non-governmental and non-partisan think tank which brings this topic to the Czech foreign policy debate. This all could not happen without the kind support of our partners. So I would very like to say thanks to the Friedrich Naumann Foundation, European Commission representation in the Czech Republic, US Embassy in Prague, and Czech Ministry of Industry and Trade. And also I would very like to thank our corporate partners, Google, UPS, CEC, Government Relations, SNUMI Agency for Translations, and Hotel Ambassador for having this extraordinary venue. At this moment, there's a such task for me. I have to apologize to Prime Minister Petr Nečas, who cancelled his participation for understandable reasons just a few hours ago. His speech will be presented by Mr. Martin Tlapa, Deputy Secretary of State for European Affairs. Minister Kuba is on his way, and he will deliver his speech as it was planned. In spite of this fact, I hope you will find this conference both interesting and stimulating, and is even will prove an inspiring experience for you. Thank you very much, and enjoy the conference.
And now, Mr. Václav Vacuski, representative of Friedrich Naumann Foundation for Freedom.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to welcome you here also on behalf of Friedrich Naumann Foundation for Freedom. We are German liberal foundation supporting democracy, rule of law, principles of free market all around the world, mostly through educational projects and political dialogue. Today, we will deal with a special topic. We will deal with a bold, daring, and truly liberal idea, connecting the two world's biggest economies into one free trade area would literally redraw the geopolitical map. I can imagine that some Czechs, well-known skeptics, could call this a little bit unrealistic. Yet, I think that this is the right time and right place to talk about this project. Europe desperately needs some vision. And we need to look ahead and change the perspective. And I think this is the right vision because free trade and free cooperation among nations is the best way how to improve international relations and how to create a solid and sustainable growth both in Europe and in the US. The idea of CAFTA, or free trade, transatlantic free trade area, is obviously not a new one. It has been dormant for many years, but the economic crisis has changed the context. And it has opened the window of opportunity for policymakers. It won't be open for long, however, and I hope that this chance won't be wasted. I want to thank my colleagues and friends from Association for International Affairs for choosing this topic and organizing this event and raising the awareness about this important issue. Before I pass the floor to the moderator, I would like to thank all of you for joining us today and making this event possible. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope that at the end of this day, we will leave this conference room with more confidence and some visions about our future. Have an inspiring conference. Thank you.
Hello to opening remarks, firstly by Mr. Ambassador Norman Eisen, the Ambassador of the United States in the Czech Republic.
Dobré ráno, reprezentanti diplomatického sboru, reprezentanti a Evropské unii, zastupci tisku, asociace pro mezinárodní otázky, vážené hosté, děkuji za tuto příležitost moci s vámi debatovat o tom, jak burání obchodních bariér může zlepšit životní úrovně a perspektivy Američanů a Evropa. On June 18th at the G8 summit in Northern Ireland, President Obama, European Commission President José Manuel Barroso, European Council President Herman Van Rompuy, and UK Prime Minister David Cameron agreed to start talks to build an agreement designed to eliminate tariffs and other barriers to trade, to boost growth, and to create jobs across the Atlantic. If successful, the agreement they propose will strengthen the world's largest two-way economic relationship. The trade talks first round will take place in July in Washington, D.C. I'm just back from D.C. where I met with the incoming U.S. trade representative, my old friend and law school classmate, Michael Froman, and the United States is very, very excited at last to begin the formal negotiations in this regard. That is because President Obama believes in free trade. He knows it to be our greatest job creation tool. While there are many different views over the value of a European single currency, virtually everyone agrees that a single market in the EU has worked tremendously well. The United States, Canada, and Mexico have enjoyed huge economic growth thanks to the North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA. We are sure that the economic benefits brought to us by NAFTA will work just as well for Europe should it enter into a TTIP. The President is seeking an ambitious deal that eliminates trade tariffs and harmonizes regulations across a broad range of industries. He and his senior economic advisors view transatlantic trade and investment as a key in the process the President began over 4 years ago to move us away from the financial crisis that started in 2008 and whose impact is still burdening our economies. Make no mistake, a US and European trade agreement will face many challenges. Groups who want to protect their narrow interests can be expected to fight the entire process. But in my view, an agreement will bring more jobs and lower prices for all of us. I suspect those of you who are attending this conference will agree. With nearly $1 trillion in bilateral trade in goods and services in 2012, the US and European trade link is supported by over $3.6 trillion in foreign direct investment and supports a combined 13 million jobs in the United States and the EU. The precarious state of the global economy underscores the challenges that the United States and Europe face and the need for growth in both our economies. We have, after all, weathered the gravest financial crisis since the Great Depression of the 1930s. As statistics clearly show, the economy of the United States has rebounded. Over the past 4 years, American businesses have created more than 6.9 million private sector jobs. Between February of 2010 and May of this year. After nearly collapsing, the U.S. auto industry has added nearly 250,000 jobs, 250,000 people employed, the fastest pace of job growth in more than a decade. Finally, American manufacturers have added more than 500,000 jobs since January 2012, the strongest period of job growth for American manufacturing in the years since 1989. President Obama would like to boost that trend by breaking down trade barriers with America's most important trading partner. Unfortunately, Europe is still confronting obstacles that are impeding growth and job creation on the continent. We both hope and expect these challenges to be temporary. The Obama administration believes that a formal trade partnership will be the mechanism that will create sustainable economic opportunity and job growth and ensure that generations of Americans and Europeans enjoy the standard of living they merit. The growing U.S.-Czech trade relationship presents us with a positive example of how we can improve our economic prospects through transatlantic trade. Between 2010 and 2012, Czech-US bilateral trade increased by more than 60%. In 2012, the US was one of the fastest growing export markets for the Czech Republic, and now the United States has become your country's largest non-European export market. In addition to the growing direct trade between the U.S. and the Czech Republic, a significant portion of Czech exports to other European nations end up in merchandise bound for the United States. So this is a difficult to measure, but very important component as to how our economies are connected through European trade. Our two nations have also taken dynamic steps to further opening our markets to each other's businesses. In December 2010, we launched the U.S.-Czech Economic and Commercial Dialogue, led on the Czech side by Minister Kuba, in order to improve both trade and investment between our nations and to seek out cooperative areas in innovation as a tool to promote commercial cooperation and encourage scientific and research collaboration. Last year, we signed the U.S.-Czech Republic Reciprocal Defense Procurement Agreement, which removes barriers and facilitates procurement of defense-related goods and services between our two countries. This agreement will allow the Czech Republic's capable defense sector to compete in the largest global military market. U.S. firms know that the Czech Republic offers unique opportunities. Joining with energetic Czech partners, American business people are pursuing new ventures with and introducing new innovative products and services to the Czech people. building wealth and creating jobs on both sides of the Atlantic. So I am optimistic about the new commercial opportunities that our countries will enjoy once transatlantic trade and investment partnership is in place. By removing the remaining barriers to trade and investment, we are taking the next steps in ensuring that our two nations can fully benefit from our growing commercial partnership, making our strong economic relationship even better. Děkuji vám za pozornost.
And now I'd like to ask Mr. Jan Michal, head of the delegation of the European Commission to the Czech Republic, for his own remarks.
Good morning, dear Minister, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. I will not continue in English, so I will leave some time for those who need to use headphones, because I attempt to continue in other official language of the European Union. Je problém pod stolu, že mohu vystoupit v úvodu dnešní konference. Chtěl bych poděkovat asociaci mezinárodních vztahů i dalším partnerům za iniciativu, která umožnila, že zde dnes můžeme diskutovat o připravované dohodě mezi Evropskou unií a Spojenými státy o obchodu a investicích. A to je několik dní poté, co členské státy Evropské unie schválily mandát pro jednání. Název dnešní konference evokuje obnovení či posílení euroatlantických ekonomických vztahů. Evropská unie i Spojené státy jsou nejen strategičtí partneři a přirození spojenci, ale pojí nás také společné dědictví, naše historie, naše kultura, naše tradice. Pojí nás také společné hodnoty. Naše společnosti jsou demokratické a otevřené. Také naše ekonomiky jsou značně otevřené. Chceme ale více. V tomto smyslu je téma dnešní konference zcela na místě. Transatlantické obchodní a investiční partnerství, jak nazýváme připravovanou obchodní dohodu, má proto odstranit další překážky ve vzájemném obchodu a současně usnadnit investování. Nápad uzavřít tuto dohodu však není zcela nový. Ale teprve v posledních letech jsme společně dospěli k závěru, že nastává správný čas tuto myšlenku realizovat. Toto rozhodnutí plyne také z přetrvávající hospodářské krize a z přesvědčení, že dohoda podnítí růst a tvorbu pracovních příležitostí na obou stranách. A bohužel také ze skutečnosti, že ustrnula vícestranná obchodní jednání ve Světové obchodní organizaci, takzvaná slová agenda zdová. Snad nebudu příliš naivní, když řeknu, že naše partnerství by také mohlo ostatní inspirovat k tomu, aby se jednání ve VTO opět oživilo. Dámy a pánové, jaké jsou očekávané přínosy dohody se Spojenými státy? Podle studie Lundského centra pro výzkum hospodářské politiky by dohoda mohla přinést prospěch ekonomice EU v řádu 100 miliard EU za rok, což odpovídá více než 500 EU na průměrnou domácnost Evropské unie. Hrubý domácí produkt Evropské unie by mohl vzrůst o 0,5% bodu. Obchodování s Evropskou unií je také velkou příležitostí pro naše partnery ve Spojených státech, a to i v současné době, kdy se eurozóna zpamatovává z hospodářské krize. Evropská unie je největším světovým trhem, je největším vývozcem i dovozcem, vykazuje nejvyšší objem investic v zahraničí a je největším světovým hostitelem investic. Neočekáváme však jen nárůst v oblasti obchodu mezi Evropskou unií a Spojenými státy. V důsledku zvýšené poptávky po surovinách, komponentech a dalších vstupech předpokládáme také zvýšení vývozu z EU do jiných zemí. Transatlantické obchodní a investiční partnerství musí představovat moderní obchodní dohodu. Z většího objemu obchodování nemohou mít prospěch jen velké nadnárodní společnosti, ale také malé a střední podniky, a to díky přímému vývozu nebo díky dodávkám do větší společnosti. Největší obchodní překážkou dnes v transatlantických vztazích nejsou cla, nýbrž překážky, tzv. Překážky za hranicemi v podobě novin. Největší potenciální hospodářský přínos dohody proto spočívá v regulační oblasti. Chceme výrobcům umožnit místo dvou odlišných režimů držet se jen jedných pravidel platných pro oba trhy. To by vzájemný obchod výrazně zjednodušilo a zlevnilo. A s ohledem na váhu obou našich ekonomik bychom se také mohli podílet na vytváření nových globálních standardů. Jde však o oblast mimořádně složitou a citlivou, protože je často spjatá s politickou, chcete-li demokratickou volbou v jiných oblastech, jako jsou ochrana zdraví či bezpečnost. Navzdory mnoha odlišnostem jsme si však mnohem blíže, než si někdy myslíme. Řečeno jinými slovy, vzájemně máme společného více než většinou jiných zemí na světě. Vážené dámy a pánové, od února letošního roku, kdy prezidenti Barroso a Van Rompuy společně s prezidentem Obamou oznámili záměr zahájit vyjednávání, jsme významně pokročili v přípravách. Schválení mandátu pro jednání se členské státy Evropské unie ztotožnili s myšlenkou dvoustranných jednání EU-USA a stanovili cíle, které by komise měla při jednáních jménem Evropské unie sledovat. Naší ambicí je zahájit jednání a pokročit v nich rychle. V žádném případě však nikoliv na úkor věcného obsahu, který musí být prvořadný. Úkol to bude mimořádně obtížný, a to jak s ohledem na stávající obchodní bariéry, včetně přístupu k veřejným zakázkám, tak s ohledem na rozdílné regulační režimy. Propojení dvou ekonomik, které patří mezi nejrozvinutější na světě a vůbec dvě největší, a které představují 1/3 celkového světového obchodu, však nemůže a nebude snadné. Bude třeba najít odpovědi na řadu legitimních otázek. Bude třeba najít řešení pro řadu velmi složitých technických problémů. Bude třeba dohodu také obhájit před veřejností i příslušnými demokratickými institucemi na obou stranách. A její výsledek bude muset být přínosem. Přínosem pro občany, pro firmy, pro členské státy, pro Unii jako celek a samozřejmě také pro našeho partnera. A to jak z hlediska bezprostředních ekonomických přínosů, tak z hlediska další kapitoly naší společné historie, respektive budoucnosti založené jak na společných hodnotách, tak na vzájemné otevřenosti našich ekonomik. Děkuji vám a přeji vám pěkný, inspirativní den.
Já děkuji Michalovi za jeho úvodní vystoupení a nyní bych požádal o slovo ministra průmyslu a obchodu České republiky, pana Martina Kubu.
Vážený pane velvyslanče, dámy a pánové, já děkuji za pozvání na toto fórum. Považuji debatu o transatlantické obchodním a investičním partnerství za jednu z nejdůležitějších, která se může vést pro, řekněme, posílení těchto vztahů a dání nové dimenze ekonomické vztahů mezi Evropou a Spojenými státy. V současné době ekonomiky Evropské unie a Spojených států v podstatě vytváří téměř polovinu světového HDP a skoro třetinu objemu celkového světového obchodu. To HDP je někde kolem 47% a podíl na světovém obchodu Evropské unie nějakých 17% a USA přes téměř 14%. Ta dohoda o volném obchodu mezi Evropskou unií a Spojenými státy, pro kterou se tedy ustálil název transatlantické obchodní a investiční partnerství, by byla bezprecedentně nejvýznamnějším bilaterálním obchodním partnerstvím a obchodní dohodou vůbec ve smyslu objemu mezinárodního obchodu, který by podléhal jejím pravidlům, a tak pokud je ovliv na mezinárodní obchod jako celek. USA a Evropská unie jsou největšími světovými obchodníky i investory obecně mezi sebou a i pro většinu třetích zemí. Celková obchodní výměna mezi Evropskou unií a Spojenými státy v roce 2011 dosáhla přes 700 miliard euro a každý den mezi Evropskou unií a Spojenými státy probíhá obchod se zbožím a službami za 2 miliardy euro. Vzájemné investice přesahují 3 biliony amerických dolarů. Uzavření dohody by podle předběžných odhadů do roku 2027 mohlo zvýšit HDP Evropské unie o 0,5% a o 0,4% HDP USA. V případě Evropské unie by to bylo podle propočtu více než 86 miliard euro roční příjmu navíc a pro USA zhruba 65 miliard euro. USA patří k našim tradičním významným obchodním partnerům, a proto v rámci strategie a exportní strategie České republiky jsou zařazeny mezi 12 prioritních zemí. Z toho důvodu my velmi významně jako Česká republika vnímáme důležitost tohoto partnerství, důležitost vytvoření rámce této dohody, protože jsme si vědomi, že jak Spojené státy, tak Evropská unie budou v budoucnu čelit nárůstu konkurenceschopnosti a růstu okolních ekonomik zemí, které ještě před pár lety zdaleka nebyly schopny konkurovat euroamerické civilizaci. A v budoucnu euroamerickou civilizaci tento souboj čeká. To znamená mnohem větší blízkost propojení těch transatlantických vazek. Je podle mého nejen důležité z pohledu budoucí obchodní výměny, ale také z budoucnosti vývoje civilizací a udržení náskoku euroatlantické nebo euroamerické civilizace nejen v obchodní, ale i politické síle v globálním měřítku. Pokud se podíváme na to, co znamená pro Českou republiku partnerství se Spojenými státy, tak vývoz České republiky do USA se v posledních letech pohybuje někde mezi 2,5 až 3,5 miliardy amerických dolarů. Spojené státy představují druhý největší vývozní trh mimo Evropskou unii a z hlediska celkového obchodního obratu jsou USA zhruba třetím největším obchodním partnerem mimo Evropskou unii. Ministerstvo průmyslu a obchodu spolu s partnerským americkým ministerstvem obchodu vytvořilo společnou platformu, která podporuje rozvoj tzv. Vzájemný ekonomický a obchodní dialog České republiky a USA. V rámci tohoto dialogu identifikujeme společně s podnikateli perspektivní projekty vzájemné hospodářské spolupráce. Usilujeme o eliminaci překážek rozvoje této spolupráce a poslední kolo těchto jednání proběhlo loni v Brně při příležitosti Mezinárodního strojírenského veletrhu. Já považuji za symbolické, že se mě letos na začátku roku při návštěvě Spojených států podařilo setkat s Mikem Fromenem, mezinárodně bezpečnostním poradcem prezidenta Obamy pro mezinárodně ekonomické vztahy, který byl podle našich informací jmenován a měl by být hlavním vyjednavačem Spojených států pro sjednání transatlantického obchodního a investičního partnerství. My jsme spolu s panem velvyslancem Eisenem a s Mikem Fromenem právě o těchto věcech hovořili. Bavili jsme se o tom, že jedním z důležitých aspektů je to symbolické uzavření této dohody, ale také, že za ní bude stát řada velmi důležitých a konkrétních kroků, které musí směřovat skutečně v těch technických parametrech k odstranění tarifních i netarifních zábran, které musí jasně vést v harmonizaci legislativy, vydefinování, řekněme, jasných parametrů toho, co jsou uznávané a neuznávané věci na obou stranách, tak abychom skutečně ty tarifní, ty netarifní překážky v tom obchodním vztahu dokázali odstranit. Česká republika jasně deklarovala, že je jedním z hlavních podporovatelů v Evropské unii vytvoření takovéto spolupráce a takovéto vztahu, a že velmi silně vnímáme jeho dopad nejen do ekonomiky České republiky, který vychází z dlouhodobého obchodních vztahů Spojených států a České republiky, ale také z dlouhodobého partnerství, které nestojí jen na ekonomických vztazích, ale že vnímáme právě ten rozměr většího propojení mezi Spojenými státy a Evropou jako nutnost posílení toho civilizačního prostoru v období, kdy globální konkurence ekonomická i politická velmi významně narůstá. Když se zmíním o pár konkrétních věcích, o kterých jsme diskutovali, my My vítáme prohlášení nejvyšších evropských představitelů a prezidenta Obamy o připravenosti obou stran k zahájení prvního kola jednání ze dne 8. července ve Washingtonu. Není pochyb o tom, že ta jednání budou velmi náročná, že obě strany budou s maximálním nasazením hájit své zájmy. A skutečnost, že jak členské země Evropské unie, tak i Spojené státy vyjádřily záměr, aby dohoda byla co nejširší a nejambicioznější, svědčí o tom, že si Evropané i Američané uvědomují skutečně historickou šanci na významný kvalitativní posun v usnadnění obchodu podnikání na obou stranách Atlantiku. Gestorským ministerstvem České republice bylo stanoveno ministerstvo průmyslu a obchodu a my už při přípravě mandátu jsme projednávali jednotlivý obsah, jednotlivý kapitol s konkrétními podnikatelskými svazy a podnikatelskými subjekty, tak, abychom dokázali vnímat jejich stanovisko a dále s nimi budeme všechny věci konkrétně diskutovat, tak jak budou negociace probíhat. Pochopitelně nelze před zahájením jednání zmiňovat jednotlivé citlivé aspekty, kterých bezesporu není málo, ale to hlavní poselství, které jsme obdrželi od podnikatelské sféry České republiky a které bych chtěl tlumočit našim americkým partnerům, zní, že zásadním faktorem, který zvýší efektivitu našeho podnikání, ta hlavním směrem, kam by vyjednavači obou stran měli soustředit nejvíc úsilí, je skutečně oblast regulatorních systémů a netarifních překážek obchodu. Jakkoliv bude předpokládaná eliminace těch celních tarifů u obchodu se zbožím přínosem, a zde už existuje hodně konkrétních číselných odhadů, tak ten nesrovnatelně větší význam skutečně vnímáme ve vzájemném uznávání, konvergenci homologačních a certifikačních systémů, technických a právních předpisů, které brzdí vzájemný obchod nejvíc. Významné bude v této oblasti sladění dosud odlišných pravidel původu. V oblasti ochrany duševního vlastnictví klademe zvláštní důraz na vzájemné uznání zeměpisných značení. Toto se týká například zemědělských nebo potravinářských výrobků. Pro zemědělce bude rovněž důležité dohodnout se na odstranění zbytečných překážek v oblasti sanitárních a fytosanitárních opatření. Stejně tak považujeme za důležitou liberalizaci v oblasti služeb. Tam existují významné překážky, zejména v oborech finančních služeb a pojišťovnictví. Přínosem by bylo usnadnění vzájemného uznávání profesních kvalifikací. V oblasti, kde se bohužel s evropským zemím nepodařilo dosáhnout jednohlasné shody v názoru na její prospěšnost a musela být proto z mandátu na jednání vypuštěna jsou audiovizuální služby. Nadále však zůstává zachována možnost otestovat v průběhu jednání, zda se názory členských států nezměnily. Dámy a pánové, toto jsou pouze detaily toho, co považují podnikatelské a české podnikatelské subjekty a svazy za konkrétní věci, které oni potřebují, aby ty vztahy, řekněme, obchodní přes Atlantik se dostávaly do kvalitativně vyšší polohy. Já jsem si dovolil tady těch pár technických parametrů zmínit proto, abychom si všichni uvědomili, že se to nejedná pouze o nějaké politické deklaratorní dohody, ale že právě tato dohoda za sebou bezesporu bude muset mít měsíce diskuzí o konkrétních technických parametrech, konkrétních detailech, konkrétních homologacích, konkrétních legislativách a konkrétních povolovacích procesech. Pokud je nezvládnou obě vyjednávací strany, ta dohoda nikdy nemůže přinést to, co se od ní očekává a co je v jejím potenciálu skryto. Pokud ale obě strany dokáží využít ten historický okamžik, využít ten historický potenciál, pokud si uvědomí, že právě tato chvíle může být něčím, co posiluje euroamerickou civilizaci oproti novým konkurentům, který vyrůstávají na globálním trhu, tak je to obrovská příležitost nejen pro Spojené státy, ale především pro Evropu, která je dnes skutečně vystavena velmi silné konkurenci a proces, který sledujeme v Evropě, je částečně dán ztrátou konkurenceschopnosti Evropské unie. Právě tato dohoda může být významným a novým startem, který může otevírat nové prostory. A já velmi věřím, že právě s takovým vědomím vyjednavači na obou stranách budou tu diskuzi vést, že si budou uvědomovat historičnost tohoto okamžiku, který může posunout ty transatlantické vztahy opět do nové dimenze tak, aby Evropa i Spojené státy
i za 20-30 let zůstávali hlavními globálními hráči a lídry světového trhu nejen ekonomicky, ale politicky. Děkuji.
Pane ministře, děkuji vám za vaše slova, která myslím pro tuto konferenci byla velice inspirativní. Jak jsem již naznačoval svém úvodním projevu, tato akce se koná pod záštitou předsedy vlády České republiky pana Petra Nečase, který do posledního okamžiku zvažoval účast, bohužel ji musel odříci. Takže jinak jsme domluveni na tom, že jeho vystoupení zde přednese náměstek státního tajemníka pro evropské záležitosti pan Martin Tlapa. Takže ho prosím, aby se ujal jménem pana premiéra slova. Děkuji.
Děkuji. Já vás vítám z těchto vystoupení pana premiéra a předsedy vlády České republiky Petra Nečase na dnešní konferenci. Vážený pane ministře, vážený pane velvyslanče, vlastní a milí hosté, dámy a pánové. Dovolte, abych srdečně poděkoval za pozvání na konferenci věnované transatlantickému obchodnímu a investičnímu partnerství. Velmi mě těší nejen dnešní publikum, početné publikum, ale také nebývalý zájem, který se na téma vyvolalo na straně kulturné veřejnosti. Nacházíme se v daleké ekonomické době, je třeba hledat nové cesty, které povedou k oživení hospodářského růstu a vytváření nových pracovních příležitostí. Zahájení jednání o bilaterální obchodní dohodě mezi Evropou a Amerikou je nejdůležitým signálem toho, že uprostřed globální finanční a ekonomické krize a navzdory některým tendencím protekcionismu jdeme cestou prohloubení liberalizace. Když nyní jsou Evropská unie a Spojené státy největšími obchodními a investičními partnery, kteří vytváří téměř polovinu světového hrubého domácího produktu a skoro třetinu objemu celkového světového obchodu. Celková obchodní výměna mezi Evropskou unií a Spojenými státy dosáhla v roce 2011 hodnoty 726 miliardy euro, což znamená, že každý den probíhá mezi Evropskou unií a Spojenými státy obchod v hodnotě 2 miliard euro. Přidáme-li ještě téměř 3 biliony euro v oblasti vzájemných přímých investic, není nejmenší pochyb, že Spojené státy a Evropská unie již v tuto chvíli vytváří největší obchodní blok na světě. Podle předběžných odhadů přispěje vytvoření zóny volného obchodu k nárůstu evropského obchodu do Spojených států až o 6%, které budou znamenat ekonomický růst Evropské unie o více než 70% hrubého domácího produktu. To se pro představu na ročnímu nárůstu 119 miliard euro ročně, což pomůže vytvořit více než milion nových pracovních míst. Na tomto místě bych rád připomněl, že tím skutečným kouzlem budoucí dohody je především to, že se jedná o vůbec nejlevnější stimulační balíček pro ekonomiku, který si lze představit. Dosavadní zkušenosti jasně ukazují, že ambiciózní dohody o volném obchodu přináší značné výhody ekonomikám obou stran a jsou důrazem, že společnými silami lze dosáhnout někdy více s méně. To je přesně ten způsob podpory hospodářství, který v současné době potřebujeme. Nezapomínejme také, že dohoda Evropské unie a Spojených států se stane nejvýznamnější bilaterální obchodní dohodou v historii nejen ve smyslu objemu mezinárodního obchodu, ale především pokud jde o vliv na mezinárodní obchod jako celek. Díky globalizované síti světových obchodních trhů a dalších řetězců budou z této dohody moci profitovat také ostatní země světa. Dohoda bude navíc jasným signálem, že oba partneři zůstávají silnými hráči globální ekonomiky, kteří mají dostatečný vliv k tomu, aby ovlivňovali a vytvářeli nová pravidla a standardy světového obchodu 21. století, která pomohou posílit multilaterální obchodní systém. V tomto ohledu bude mít dohoda zajisté výrazný vliv na jednání na půdě světové obchodní organizace. V době, kdy mnohostranná jednání v rámci rozvojové agendy z Dohá stojí na místě, můžeme právě tímto krokem přinést nové impulzy k prohloubení mnohostranného světového obchodu. Co přinese uzavření dohody České republice? Doufám si říci, že nic zanedbatelného. Spojené státy patří k našim tradičním a významným obchodním partnerům. Patří mezi prioritní země v rámci exportní strategie na leta 2012 a 2020. V roce 2012 dosáhla vzájemná obchodní výměna 131 miliard korun, což představuje 2% podíl celkovém českém zahraničním obchodu. Spojené státy pro Českou republiku představují druhou nejvýznamnější zemi mimo Evropskou unii z hlediska celkového obchodního obratu. Je nutné si uvědomit, že přínosy lze spatřovat pouze v odstranění celních sazeb, které jsou v mnoha oblastech nízké, i když existují samozřejmě v této oblasti výjimky. Těžiště dohody bude bez pochyby především v odstranění ochranářských opatření netarifních a regulatorních překážek, které omezují naše podniky a vývozu Spojených států nejvíce. Stěžejním aspektem jednání bude také liberalizace přístupu k veřejným zakázkám, a to zejména na subfederální úrovni. Diametrálně odlišná regulace v oblasti životního prostředí, ochrany zdraví, bezpečnosti obyvatel tvoří naprostou většinu bariér volného obchodu. Naprostá většina těchto opatření, která jsou běžná na obou stranách Atlantiku, má své opodstatnění. Rozlišné právní úpravy však mají za následek, že mnohé procedury mohou být nejen nepotřebné, ale často také kontraproduktivní. Já osobně se cítím stejně bezpečně při řízení automobilu české výroby na českých silnicích, jako při řízení amerického automobilu, který se vyučí ve Spojených státech. Vzájemné uznávání certifikace a zjednodušení licenčních procedur přinese obrovskou úlevu administrativní zátěže na straně našich podniků. Jsem pevně přesvědčen, že finanční prostředky, které jsou nyní zbytečně vynakládány na dvojí testování výrobků či opakované inspekční prohlídky, mohou být našimi podniky efektivně vynaloženy k vytváření nových pracovních míst a inovací svých produktů. Musíme společně budovat taková pravidla, která budou reflektovat vysoké standardy ochrany životního prostředí a zdraví našich občanů a která zároveň uleví nadbytečné zátěži našim podnikatelům. Řada legislativních opatření, které v současnosti platí na federální a subfederální úrovni Spojených států, omezuje možnosti účasti evropských firm na výběrových řízeních státními subjekty. Pokud se pomocí dohody podaří tyto překážky odstranit, bude otevřený prostor pro české firmy k účasti v amerických veřejných zakázkách nejspíše největším přínosem pro českou ekonomiku. Podle předběžných odhadů přinese liberalizace vzájemných obchodních a ekonomických vztahů významný pozitivní dopad na hrubý domácí produkt české ekonomiky. Optimální scénář je hovoří o ekonomickém růstu až 2% a vytvoření až 22 000 nových pracovních příležitostí. Za velmi perspektivní obory pro českou ekonomiku lze považovat především energetiku, dopravu a služby, informační technologie, výzkum a vývoj. Neméně důležité bude vyjednat dobré podmínky pro náš letecký a ochranný průmysl a výrobky v oblasti zdravotnictví, antropologie a biotechnologie. Nezapomeneme také na fakt, že Spojené státy nejsou jen zajímavým trhem pro české výrobky, ale jsou také významným investorem a zaměstnavatelem v České republice. Celková výše investic amerických firm na našem území dosáhla v roce 2011 hodnoty bezmála 3,5 miliardy euro, což představuje zhruba 5% celkových přímých zahraničních investic v České republice. I proto Česká republika podporuje, aby součástí dohody byla mimo jiné kapitola ochrany investic. Jsem pevně přesvědčen, že ekonomické přínosy nejsou zanedbatelné. Přesto je velmi důležité se vyhodnit, že dopady dohody nelze očekávat i hned. Nejen samotná jednání, ale také následná implementace dohody si vyžádá určitý čas. Nevidíme však minulost ani přítomnost, snažíme se vytvořit vzájemně výhodný právní rámec pro budoucnost. Vážené dámy, vážení pánové, závěrem bych rád zdůraznil, že jednání podle mého soudu nebudou jednoduchá, což ostatně potvrdil již otevřené diskuze v rámci přípravy mandátu zmocňující Evropskou komisi k vyjednávání. Proti sobě stojí dva rovnocenní partneři, kteří budou tvrdě hájit své národní zájmy a priority. Nacházíme se na počátku cesty, která nebude v žádném případě snadná. I přesto pevně věřím, že pokud přetrvá politická vůle, která je nyní cítit z obou stran Atlantiku, dosáhneme ambiciózního výsledku v podobě dohody reflektující citlivé otázky obou stran. Dohody, jak bude postavená na společných hodnotách, a dlouhodobé pohodlání budovat a šířit myšlenky volného obchodu. Dohody, jež výrazným dílem přispěje k překonání globální krize, obnově hospodářského růstu a vytváření nových pracovních míst v době, kdy je to nejvíce třeba. Děkuji za pozornost, přeji vám všem dobré.
Děkuji.
Minister, Your Excellency Ambassador, dear guests, I thank you very much for your participation in the beginning of this conference. We will now continue the presentation of policy paper and with the first panel. So I would like to ask Elena Bryan and Mark van Hokelen and Vilém Semerák, to take their places, and I thank you very much again for your speeches.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Vilém Semerák, and I've been asked to present a paper which I prepared for this conference, which is focused on an evaluation of expected effects of the proposed trade and investment partnership, especially on the Czech Republic. I apologize to some of you for using English. I was asked by organizers to prepare the presentation in English. It's not because I would deliberately like to torture the interesting language. So let's look at the basic data and our conclusions. But before that, let's start with a little bit of background. First of all, I should mention that I'm an economist, and we typically are the boring guys who tend to spoil the party by presenting too many numbers and sometimes too skeptical numbers. I hope it will not be that much the case here today. So first of all, when we look at the background and a little bit also at the very interesting history of the proposal. So as we all know, the EU is extremely active in negotiating preferential trade arrangements and free trade agreements all over the world. In fact, there are basically a handful of countries in the current global economy which don't have any special trade or investment regime with the EU. Even today, special agreements are being negotiated with Canada, Japan, lots of other countries. So the question is, why do we observe very strange fact that the two logical allies, the two countries which owe each other a lot, which used to collaborate very closely economically in their post-war development, which are the closest political allies, why they don't have any special arrangement like that? When asking this question, we actually may find out that we have tried, not only, of course, the US helped Europe with Marshall Plan really to restart the process of European integration, but even the 1990s, already after the end of the Cold War, EU has tried to create a special regime for mutual trade. That was the famous draft of the new transatlantic marketplace, which in some features wasn't too different from what we see today. The story of that was quite interesting. The motives mentioned at that time are not only the promotion of mutual trade, but also it was the attempt to find some common topic for cooperation in political affairs after the Cold War has ended. If we look at both of these reasons, basically it's very similar like what we see today. The draft failed pretty miserably. Just a few months later, the real unofficial reason for the failure seems to be the fact that France didn't really like some of the expected provisions for liberalization and services. So we may hope that this time, somehow, we will avoid this kind of pitfall. Later, we saw another attempt how to start trade liberalization on a real level, although they were less advertised. Most importantly, I'd like to mention the Transatlantic Economic Council, which has been trying for some time to identify the biggest problems, especially monetary measures, and which has been trying to discuss possible remedies, alas, without too much effect in many troubled areas. So what are the main causes or the main reasons why we should be meeting here today and discuss the proposal? We can divide them into two broad categories. Of course, the economic effects, which include the direct economic gains from trade, which are actually likely to be in the long run a little bit less important, especially when you look at the direct gains from tariff elimination, more intensive mutual investment with assumed increased efficiency in investment allocation, both due to facilitation of investment environment and because of liberalization in trade services, and very importantly, increased competitiveness of both EU and US companies due to, first, the existence of larger common market, and second, very importantly, because they will be dealing with similar type of regulation, which they even may help design, and which will help them become possibly the norm centers and trend centers in global economy. The second set of motives is political. It was voiced very clearly, for instance, by Zbigniew Brzezinski at the recent WhatsApp meeting in Bratislava, and it somehow implies that this is what we may need to reignite the process of transatlantic geopolitical collaboration. This is what we may need if we want to create some successful global bloc, successful global actor consisting of the EU and of the United States. I'm a little bit more skeptical about this second set of motives. I think maybe actually the other way around. This will be the test of our willingness to collaborate. Plenty of the issues dealing with non-tariff barriers will be so difficult to argue that we will see in the end whether our motives to collaborate are strong enough to overcome the burden. Perhaps the most important motive then on the European side is something which could be seen or read somehow between the lines of speeches of several US officials. There is a danger that the US may lose interest to some extent in European affairs. After all, the EU in the past years, that's always the problem because of internal disputes, because of a less clear representation of the Union, and because of the unfinished issues related to the problems of the EU. So maybe in the end, we may need this kind of proposal to motivate the US not to lose patience with Europe and not to lose the interest in European affairs. But now to the main expected stumbling blocks. We expect that tariffs may be relatively simple to deal with. After all, plenty of the tariff protection have been already eliminated. There are a few problems which remain, so-called tariff spikes and issues related to not only tariff but related to subsidies and other forms of protection as well. These are mainly typical for agriculture and sometimes for the food-related products. Well, this is very important for the EU trade, for the stability of negotiations. It's a little bit less relevant for the Czech Republic, because as you all know, the Czech foreign trade doesn't really consist that much in exporting the agri-foods related products. But next, the big category, as my predecessors already mentioned here, will be the monetary measures, which is incredibly rich, wide, complicated, and troublesome category to negotiate. Nevertheless, this is the category that must be dealt with if the agreement is to succeed and if it is to have any real implications. So, if we start from the end, the most complicated topic, which has made it to tabloid press already, and that's the issue of technical safety norms and regulations. Most importantly, what concerns the public are the phytosanitary regulations. It is not only about finding the right measure of protection. Unfortunately, what we are dealing with here is fundamentally different attitude to regulation. When we look at regulation of phytosanitary measures, the United States preferred so-called sound science attitude. That means a product can be sold, it can be introduced to the market. In principle, if there is no scientific evidence showing that the product can be harmful to human health. The EU very much promotes so-called precautionary safety or preliminary caution principle. That means sometimes at the EU side, it's sufficient if someone is simply worried that there could be a problem in the future and all the relevant implications have not been fully explored. So let us introduce the protection now and let us wait for future evidence. But let us be cautious before we allow the product to the market. This leads to very fundamentally different attitudes to protection, and therefore, protection of human health, not so much trade protection, and therefore, we actually are going to negotiate about the convergence of mindsets of the regulators, not so much only about particular measures. This is going to be incredibly difficult. It will be even more difficult than the previous similar attempts in other agreements, let's say the EU-Korea or US-Korea agreement, because this time we are talking about two countries, two markets, which actually are fairly proud of the achieved regulation and which assume that it is their regulation which is the correct one, and maybe the other market should be the one which accommodates. I'm not quite sure how this will be dealt with, but what I'm sure about is that we will again hear about US chlorinated chickens in European tabloids in the next few months very loudly. The second big category are government procurement issues. The EU has smartly liberalized internal government procurement. We are fairly used to the fact that governments may buy foreign commodities, foreign services, even though even here there are several possible measures which should be addressed. On the other hand, in the US, the Buy American has become a very popular slogan, which the US government has used also as a way not to fight the financial crisis. Let us help domestic business by buying American. Again, to change this mindset, that would be very difficult to explain to the public that the government may decide to buy abroad, import European products, instead of helping domestic business. I'm not quite sure how easy this will be to negotiate. And then the famous issue of geographical indications. Obama's inauguration party led to outcry of discontent in France, actually, because the champagne, or the, we should say perhaps the sparkling wines served there, was actually called champagne, even though it was produced, I believe, somewhere in California. This was the proverbial red rag for French farmers and for French politicians. If this agreement succeeds in somehow harmonizing this kind of rules, either the product would have to be renamed, which of course may be relatively difficult to accept from the US side, or maybe we will allow them to produce the product and export it even as champagne to Europe, which is of course very difficult to palate for the French side. If you look at all these measures, government procurement, geographical indication, safety and technical regulation, we see that this is really a nightmare for negotiators. It's quite likely that we'll be negotiating on this for basically years. On the other hand, from the perspective of Czech Republic, there is something hidden in this as well.
It's exactly the type of measures that we used to have problem with when we were getting into Europe. So actually, if these measures are addressed, there is additional source for invisible and yet difficult to estimate gains, and that is improved access of Czech service providers and goods producers, not only to the US market, but also facilitation of our trade with the EU, with other European countries. So this is actually what we should focus on also as Czech Republic and Czech negotiators. The service sector. As of now, the service sector has got two faces, basically. Large part of services are basically deregulated, or rather regulation, proper regulation, has not been introduced there. And there are several specific types of services which tend to be very important where the regulation exists and it is substantial. On the US side, financial services, internal transportation, cabotage. On the EU side, especially the topic that was now excluded from the negotiations by France, audiovisual services. This is again a huge opportunity, especially for Europe, developed Europe. As of now, it seems to be a slightly bit directly, slightly less directly relevant for the Czech Republic, because as of now, we are not so strong exporter of services. Nevertheless, it may be an opportunity for us for the future. So, let us now look at the effects of the TTIP, and before I get to the numbers, I will try to explain why the numbers look the way they look like. First of all, there are quite a few problems or burdens which constrain the future expected effects of trade liberalization on Czech, especially Czech economy. Before getting to this, maybe I will start with this picture. As my predecessors said here already, Czech economy exports just over 2% of our exports to the United States. And what is worse, when we look at empirical models of Czech trade, this pattern seems to be relatively stable. What we often criticize as the extremely Eurocentric pattern of Czech trade seems to be fairly natural, and therefore also relatively difficult to change. So the share of the US, even in the case of very successful FTA, which goes to removal of many non-trade barriers, the increase will be very, very gradual. Now, what does it mean? This small share in our trade also severely restricts the opportunities for gains. So if we simply try something very static, just input-output analysis of our trade flows with the US and their effects on the Czech economy, and if we, for instance, estimate, or if we somehow assume that trade flows increase by staggering 100%, which is fairly unlikely actually, still we would get something like 1% plus increase in the Czech GDP, annual GDP, simply because of the current relatively small base from which we are starting. So that's the first possible constraint for the effect. The second constraint of concerning effects on the Czech Republic is the current relatively low level of protection. We look at the current average tariffs, especially on in the category of non-agriculture, which includes manufacturing products, so relevant for our exporters. We see that the United States only apply on average 3.3% tariff rate, which is actually a fairly small number compared to other real barriers to trade, such as exchange rate volatility, transportation costs, which are not going to disappear overnight. Plus, plenty of the tariffs actually rather function today as a kind of nuisance tariffs. So there is actually a very low tariff rate, often let's say 0.102%. And what acts as inhibitor to trade is not a tariff rate, but rather the formalities of the tariff procedures. Now, this will not disappear that easily. US exporters to Europe, when they are exporting to Europe later, will still be struggling with dealing with the value-added tax after the goods arrive to the European markets. So some of these formalities, again, will not disappear that easily. And we can assume that some reciprocity will guarantee that the same kinds of problems may appear on the US side as well. In addition to this, besides the low level of average tariffs, over 50% of current trade flows are already without any positive tariff rate. So there is basically zero tariff already on 50% of our trade flows in non-agricultural products. If you look at this, and if you remove the tariffs, obviously the expected effects are not going to be too high. What next? As I already mentioned, some of the barriers will persist. So exchange rate volatility, that's actually slightly less known barrier, which tends to hit Czech exporters to the US slightly higher than European exporters, because Europe tends to be, on average, slightly less volatile to dollar than the Czech crown. So this will cause it for our exporters, it will still be a little bit easier to export to the Eurozone if you are, even if you are not members, than to the US. Plus, there will be still the transportation cost and related procedures which will act as the inhibitor to trade. Some barriers may even increase. That's the problem with rules of origins, so typical for the free trade areas, especially if liberalization in some very sensitive areas leads to strict insistence on the fact that this liberalization is mainly for goods originating in the US. Some of the formalities related to proving that goods trade came from the US may initially create additional burden for trade. So this is the reason why, especially when we look at estimates of so-called static effect, and especially effects which include only reduction in tariff protection, why they're like this more. Before getting to our numbers, I will just review here some of the interesting estimates done by SCP, by the Bertus Foundation study, and by the Francois study done for the European Commission. When you look at the overall effects on the EU, we typically see fairly moderate increases in exports to the US, typically something like 7 to 8%, especially for the static scenarios, and even smaller effects on the GDP. So the S&P study actually found something like 0.01% contribution to GDP in their most conservative scenario, a scenario which mainly focused on tariff reduction, and which did not take into account possible subsequent increases in competitiveness of European companies. When these additional possible effects on productivity are included, the gains increase, but it's still close at most to about 1% of the GDP. If you look at the United States, the picture is not too different. Mostly, the United States gets slightly higher estimates simply because of the fact that we are merging two markets which are of slightly unequal size. We are providing the US with access to slightly bigger EU market than the EU market which is getting access to slightly smaller US market. So this leads to some of these differences in the relative effects. Nevertheless, if you look at the total expected benefits, they remain extremely conservative. A skeptical accountant or economist could even say that we are on the verge of statistical significance. It's not so extreme to call these results basically a positive zero. How does it look like with the Czech Republic? As I said, we mainly focus currently on exports of commodities, many of which probably will benefit relatively less, simply because the production has been already addressed to a substantial degree. So if you look at the absolutely most conservative scenario, which focuses on tariffs, and which doesn't assume any additional high gains in productivity of Czech companies, we are actually at somewhere like 0.01% of additional GDP gained by the agreement, which is, as I should say correctly, indeed too low to be statistically meaningful. Fortunately for us, this is simply the guarantee, or we should see this as the guarantee, that we cannot lose from the agreement. And I should say another issue. When we look at every single one of trade agreements negotiated in recent years and the ones which are being discussed today, there is no other agreement which actually does too much better in terms of direct gains. We have reached the stage of international trade relations when many of the most favored nation clause rates, especially on manufactured goods, are so low that it's difficult to expect too dramatic direct gains in exports and in GDP. When we compare this with other more ambitious estimates, this is the result of the Bertelsmann Foundation study, which and decided a different approach. They were trying to trade the development of the economy still 2025, assuming fairly liberally additional increases in productivity of the companies. In their case, and possibly the highest estimate I have found for the Czech Republic as of now, they would assume that the real incomes per capita in the Czech Republic could increase by up to 2.5%. So that's nothing extreme, but also not exactly negligible. So the conclusion of this would be that we are sure that the trade agreements will hurt the Czech economy. It may actually reinforce not only positions of Czech companies in the US market, it may also increase or improve positions of Czech companies on non-EU, non-US markets because of their higher level of competitiveness. So there is no reason why the Czech Republic should not support the agreement. We should be just a little bit cautious when presenting the agreement to the public so that we do not create the effect which became typical, for instance, for the NAFTA agreement, where the policymakers often overpromised and the public then felt rightfully disappointed that the real effects were slightly lower than what the politicians and policymakers originally suggested. So my conclusion would be that there is nothing that we can lose from this proposal for TTIP. The deeper it goes, the better for the Czech Republic. The Czech government should definitely support the negotiations as much as we can, because especially the non-trade measures debate can support competitiveness of Czech companies even in the EU market. The question is whether we can credibly promise any too tangible, too direct, and too visible gains to the Czech public. Thank you for your attention.
So, ladies and gentlemen, we can continue. So, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, the TTIP, this is really not only a process, it's not only an act, but also the brand today. Let me introduce you some newspapers, headlines. First, the European Union newspaper. This is the biggest trade deal of all time. Now, the US newspaper getting in bet with Europe. Well, we have a great expectations about it. We have to discuss about the pros and cons. We have to discuss about the opportunities and threats. We have to discuss about the real impacts on the public sector, on the business sector, because we are talking about 22 million SMEs, the small and medium enterprises in the European Union, and 23 million small businesses in the United States of America. And we have to discuss the impacts on the consumer sector, because we are talking about 800 million inhabitants. It's a pleasure for me to welcome the Czech Republic, welcome on the stage excellent speakers. As a first, let me introduce you, Elena Bryan, the senior trade representative at the Office of the United States Trade Representative at the U.S. Commission to the European Union. I have to say that Elena, she has a large experience with international trade and development, not only in America, but also in the European Union, and of course in Asia. It's a pleasure to meet, it's a pleasure to welcome Mark van Hoekelen, head of cabinet, very important cabinet of the European Commission, head of cabinet of Karel de Gucht, the member of the European Commission for Trade. I have to say that Mark van Hoekelen was also the head of relationships with US and Canada, and he has a large experiences in the academic sector. It's a pleasure for me to welcome the representatives of the Czech Republic, Mr. Milan Hovorka. Milan Hovorka is one of the most experienced public manager, government manager in the Czech Republic from the point of view of international affairs and trade and development. Today he's the Deputy Minister of Industry and Trade of the Czech Republic, and he was a permanent representative to the WTO and United Nations. First, it's a pleasure for me to welcome Mr. Martin Tlapa, Deputy State Secretary for European Affairs of the Office of the Government of the Czech Republic. Also, Martin has a large experience with the European Union many years ago, collaborating at the level of small and medium enterprises. My name is Karel, I'm the chairman of the Association of Small and Medium Enterprises of the Czech Republic, and let's start in the United States of America. Elena.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here in Prague and to talk about an initiative that I think is now consuming my life and will consume the rest of my tenure in Brussels. But as a trade negotiator, we like to negotiate agreements, and this agreement with the EU will be the largest single trade agreement that's ever been negotiated on a bilateral basis. Across the Atlantic, we trade about 2 billion euro worth of goods every day. We've invested in one another about 2.8 trillion euro. Between the US and the EU, we have nearly 50% of world GDP and are responsible for about 30% of world trade. And trade supports about 13 million jobs on either side of the Atlantic. This will also be the first agreement where the two parties to the agreement are roughly equal economic heft. Both the US and EU have a variety of FTAs with other partners. But frankly, neither of us has ever concluded an agreement with a partner of roughly the same size and importance. What are the objectives of TTIP? Very clearly, growth and jobs. We've heard this from our leaders. President Obama has been very vocal about this. My new boss, the USTR, Mike Froman, has played a key role in this effort since the beginning of the high-level working group on jobs and growth nearly 2 years ago. We have heard from the leaders of most, if not all, member states supporting the effort to use trade to produce increased jobs and growth. There are five basic objectives that we've agreed on for TTIP, which is eliminating or reducing conventional barriers in trade, including tariffs and tariff rate quotas. I know our economic colleague noted that many of the tariffs are nuisance at this point, and that our tariffs are generally low, but each side pays about $4 billion in tariffs to the other every year. And that's not an insignificant amount of money. We're also looking to eliminate, reduce, or better discipline, prevent barriers to trade in goods, services, investment. We'd like to enhance the compatibility of regulations and standards. We'd like to take a run at behind the barrier quarters. And we're also looking to cooperate and collaborate on a variety of issues, which sometimes are called 21st century issues, that may not be of particular problem in the transatlantic trade, but are where we face common challenges around the world, and where there are not established international rules yet. Why are we doing this now? Sometimes we talk about having seen this movie before, and the ending wasn't quite as we'd like. So what's changed to make the movie end in a more positive note this time? I think there's a variety of factors at play. One is obviously we've both been through economic crises. We're both looking for growth in our economies. I think both the US and the EU have looked to Asia for growth, but we still believe that there are more opportunities to achieve growth in the transatlantic market. We have leaders who are showing the political will to embark on this agreement. There are a number of new actors. I would say the world has changed. There are new actors in the world, including in the world of international trade, who are challenging developed economies to become more competitive and efficient. And technology has changed. A lot of what we do now, at least on the government side, is based on technology of many years ago, particularly at the regulatory side. Are there possibilities to update those regulations, to regulate smarter, to regulate better, to focus more on areas of high risk and less on areas where we have similar levels of standards and similar outcomes? So what's happened in the last 2 years? We were given the challenge in November of 2011 now by our leaders. When I say we, that was USTR at the time, Ambassador Ron Kirk, and Mark's boss, Commissioner Karel de Gucht, to take a hard look at whether the conditions were there to come out with a significant agreement. After about 15 months of intense work, we decided that the conditions were indeed there and that we believed we could ultimately achieve a comprehensive agreement. During that process, and since the high-level working group final report was announced in February, both sides have spent a lot of time consulting with stakeholders, consulting with our legislators, and anyone that had a view that they wanted to share with us. We both had domestic legal processes that we needed to follow to get to the point where we are today, which is the actual start of negotiations on July 8th. 2 weeks ago, the European Council approved a mandate. We get in trouble in Brussels when I say mandate. Negotiating directives, the Commission. We finished a 90-day consultation period with our Congress. 91st day was last Wednesday. We're now ready to start the negotiations, and as I mentioned, we'll have the first round starting on the 8th of July in Washington. Throughout the process of negotiation, the good news is we know what the issues are. The bad news is we know what the issues are. The good news is that we all know each other because many of us have worked together, including in the regulatory side for many years. The bad news is we all know each other. It's not going to be very easy. It's going to take a lot of hard, careful work and a lot of consultations with our stakeholders. But the potential gain is huge. We need to get this going. We need to get it done as expeditiously as we can without sacrificing substance. And we need to ensure that we can have as large an agreement as possible. But that doesn't mean it will include everything. And there is a need for everyone to understand that it's not going to be the agreement that fixes every issue that was ever out there. We want to come up with an agreement that can be politically supported on both sides and yield, hopefully, substantial benefits. I think I will stop there. Thank you.
Thank you. Mark is a key person in the European Union, which is a point of view, and would like to discuss also with Mike about the real impacts on the European environment, because I hope that will be not only a symbolic act. So, please, Mark.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning to you all. Thank you for having me here. Glad to see that there is a keen interest in the Czech Republic about TTIP and not only in the Brussels habitat. A lot has already been said this morning, and I'm not sure what people have been said. try to make 4 points. First of all, the EU and the US have already, of course, a very intense economic relationship. It is a dense relationship in, from the point of view of trade, but it is an even more dense relationship in terms of investment. Europe trades clearly more with China than with the US. But the relationship between the EU and the US is unparalleled in the world with regard to investment. There are, as Elena already said and a few others as well, right now there are 40 million people working for multinationals from the other side. In the Czech Republic, there are 75,000 people working for American multinationals. So that relationship is already very strong, yet we believe that there is still a lot of mileage to be had from further deepening. Various studies have been made on the gains from TTIP, and I think Mr. Simira has reviewed them skillfully. And as an economist, I know that these studies are important but difficult to do. I think that it's fair to say that over the medium term, TTIP should bring something like 0.5% or 1% of GDP extra compared to what we would have had we not done the TTIP. Is that a lot? I tend to compare this with what we did within the European Union when we completed the internal market from 1985 to about the end of the 90s, so over a 10-15 year period. We now know historically that that has brought us a growth bonus of about 2.5 to 5%. In other words, TTIP may bring 1/5 of the completion of the internal market. You can say, well, what is 0.5% of GDP? Well, on the one hand, it's not all that big. We should grow annually between 1 and 2%. But still, it's not a laughing matter either. It represents something like 500 euros per family in the European Union. In addition, economic growth is slack. We need to find pockets of growth where we can find them. In the next 15 years, 90% of world growth will be outside the European Union. So we need to tap into the growth potential of others in order to take our engine into higher gear. This FTA can be called easily, without too much time, the mother of all FTAs. It's going to be the mother of all FTAs. Because this is the FTA between the two biggest economies in the world. And secondly, we are going into territory that has not been charted yet. Because obviously we want to work a lot on tariffs. But there are 7, 8, 9 areas that are going to be much more important, but that are also going to be more difficult to crack. Let me mention them when I say a few words on what I believe to be the main prize. So let me mention them. It's public procurement. It's not only about TTIP, it's also about TTIP, so we don't have an investment agreement. It's about liberalization of services. It is about taking the barriers to trade and sanitary, phytosanitary problems, subjects that quickly give rise to a lot of emotions. It's going to be on IPRs, it's going to be on rules of origin, but above all, it's going to be on regulatory cooperation. That is where the main benefits will be, if we can deliver on regulatory cooperation. Not so much that is my view, not so much in order to overcome existing barriers. That's important. It's going to be very hard, very frustrating. But much more importantly, to set up mechanisms so as to avoid the emergence of future pandemic. Because what exists today will no longer be relevant in 10 years' time in terms of retribution. What we need to put in place are systems of upstream cooperation that avoid future pandemic. This is not going to be easy, because both sides want more convergence. Both sides want more compatibility, but of course always on their terms. In April, I was in Washington and I discussed for 2 days with regulators. And that's great fun. But after a while, you also would like to take a bit of Prozac. And that's normal, because regulators don't have it in their job description to avoid non-tariff barriers. That's not their job description. They need to make sure that the rules are there for public health, public safety, and the environment. They do their work, and their colleagues on the other side of the pond do their work to the best of their ability, and what you often have then is non-tariff barriers. This is, as I said, the big objective. Because if we can't do it, Americans, Europeans, we cannot do it with anyone else. Because we have so many things in common in terms of what we believe is important and what is not. If I rent a car in the US, I feel safe. And yet we still have lots of differences in regulations. I tend to think that when Elena rents a car in Europe, she also feels more or less safe. If I feel sick in the US, I take pills, bought at a local grocery, and I believe that I'm in good hands. I think the same holds for Americans taking pills in the EU. Yet, we still have vast differences in regulatory approaches, leading to massive costs in EU. At the end of those 2 days in Washington, I had a glimmer of hope, because I heard a story about an area where I thought the barriers would be biggest, and no, it isn't true. It's the area where the cooperation has gone furthest. That's on aviation safety. It is amazing what American and Europeans have done together. Essentially, when the US considers a new Boeing airworthy, we recognize that. If we consider a new Airbus airworthy, the FAA basically recognizes that. Most Boeings flying around in the world are serviced in Europe. If we can do that with regard to aviation safety, why can't we do this for medical devices? Why can't we do this for cars? Why can't we do this for chemicals? Why can't we do this for pills, cosmetics, financial services? So that is the real issue. Do we have what it takes to think out of the box and to be aggressively pragmatic? Because if we stand on our own orthodoxy, we won't go all that far. We need to be very pragmatic. Final point I want to make. Is this bad for the rest of the world? Because we're the two biggest economies of the world together in, say, nominal value terms, we're still close to 50% of the world economy, purchasing power standards about 14%. Obviously, our share is declining. That's nothing to be sad about. You cannot say that you would like Indians and Chinese to get out of poverty and then at the same time feel bad about the fact that we are having so much of a decline in our relative importance. If hundreds of millions of Chinese and Indians have been able lift themselves out of poverty. That's a good thing. Obviously, it means that our share in the world GDP then declines. Now, what the studies have shown is that the rest of the world is definitely not going to suffer. There will be extra income for the rest of the world. In addition, the TTIP is not a whole bunch of undermining the multilateral trading system. What we're going to do in the TTIP are things that are not on the cards for the foreseeable future in the WTO. Regulatory cooperation, the way we see it, is going to be groundbreaking and will be some sort of format that the rest of the world can take inspiration from. So this is a great undertaking. I think TTIP will change a bit of the lives of many, definitely of us. We'll have to stay longer in the office than is even the case now. But it is indeed a big show in town. What is important is that politicians, as well as civil society and the private sector, keep their eyes on the ball and keep our feet to the fire. It will be hard. It will be bumpy. Definitely, if you want to do this fast, USTR Thurman and Commissioner Riffy believe it can be done within 2 years, which would be breathtakingly fast. But on the other hand, where there is a political will, there's a technical way. Let me leave it at that.
Mark, thank you very much. We'll continue in a few minutes because we have some questions to you. But now we can discuss with Milan Hovorka. How I said, Mark is a key person of TTIP in the European Union. I just said that Milan is the key president of TTIP in the Czech Republic because he's managing the implementation of TTIP in the Czech environment. So let's discuss about the troubles, about the key factors and critical factors by implementation into the own environment, please.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pippin-Pellet, and I'm asking my fellow compatriots of mine to bear with me if I speak English. I too would like to join others in expressing my gratitude first to the Association for International Affairs for bringing us together. This clearly is a giant initiative. When approached, I was told that probably it would be too late, as some important decisions would have been already taken at the time. And it's true that both Americans and Europeans now seem to be ready to start negotiations. But we are in a very critical phase because we are not yet there. Both teams are just about to prepare negotiating tactics, what would be the best strategies to prepare for the first round of negotiations to take place, as we heard in Washington, D.C. on July 8th. But then, and that's why it's so important that we are meeting together today, it is to generate better understanding of what we are talking about, to explain to our stakeholders, our businesses, but also representatives of civil society, what are our objectives, what are our intentions. We have to be able to dispel certain doubts, concerns many have about impacts of the agreement once it has been negotiated. And this would be my first remark, that if we are not able to generate public support for the project, we will be running the risk of leaving the negotiating table without any concrete result. Then, I believe Mark mentioned, others also pointed that it won't be an easy endeavor, and I fully agree. And at the same time, the idea of establishing free trade zone across the Atlantic is not totally new. For many, this is clearly a historic opportunity. I have been in the shop for 25 years. I tell you, I would even say 5-7 years ago, to talk about the possibility of launching negotiations between the EU and US on a trade and investment agreement. Almost impossible, I'll tell you. We all know that we will have to deal with issues that have been on the table for years, I would say decades. In some of them, the differences are of such magnitude that have to be settled neither in Washington nor in Brussels, but in Geneva, in the dispute settlement system established by the World Trade Organization. But despite all these challenges, despite all the difficulties, we believe that it is worth of effort, that we have to proceed, that we have to proceed now. But at the same time, to be honest, it was not so easy to agree on what we call negotiating mandate for the Commission. And I tell you that for us, for Czechs, the most important was to get the process right, not to put our negotiator, who is the Commission, under artificial strike jacket. We were supportive of a mandate that is sufficiently broad, that gives the Commission that flexibility it needs, if really are serious in our intentions. And you know, this type of negotiation, it is a give and take. You have to be ready to offer something if you want to pocket something meaningful. And this is also why we resisted and we have been quite vocal against any attempt to exclude already now any sector, any policy area, because of obvious reasons, then it would have immediate reaction of our partners around the table, the US. If we exclude all the visual services, then what the US will do clearly? Will do the same in reconsidering the position, and let's say, will not be enthusiastic about bringing on board issues give you an example, GIs that are close to hearts of many in Europe, including the Czech Republic. And here I have to be very clear to say, and maybe to correct slightly, and I apologize, Mr. Semerák, to whom I am grateful for very, very professional presentation. Audiovisual services have not been excluded from the negotiation. Audiovisual services have not been included in the mandate, but the Commission got the authorization to come back and to seek additional mandates based on request and in context with the US during negotiations. Definitely, Karel, you mentioned about the implementation of the transatlantic trade and investment partnership. Definitely, we are not yet there. It will take us some effort, really, to go through all these difficult issues. And I will not repeat them because my predecessors, they did very good job. But if we talk about investment, Martin, we mentioned we are strongly in favor of having investment there. But consider the situation that German companies heavily invested in the US. There is a huge number of American companies that do extremely good business in Germany. And this has happened without any bilateral investment agreement. So now we will have to be instrumental in explaining to people, okay, if we want to have it, what would be the value added? Because there are many who are afraid that the inclusion would give rise to many investor to state disputes. And we have done our maximum in reflecting this concern in the negotiating mandate for the Commission. And definitely that we have countries like the Czech Republic. We do have our own bilateral investment agreement with the United States. So the question is, what will happen if we succeed in negotiating transatlantic trade and investment partnership? And I was quite vocal when having opportunity to address this subject to say that at the end of the day, if we are successful, there should be only one set of investment rules to be implemented between the US and the European Union. There are certain commentaries regarding the timing timeframes. Some point to the possibility of concluding these negotiations sometimes in the second half, late 2014. And with full respect to these views, my personal view is that it will not happen in 2014. If we are serious in our intentions to have something that is comprehensive, that is sufficiently ambitious, I believe it will take a bit more time. I would be more than pleased if I am wrong in my assumptions. But this is clearly based on, I hate to say similar project, because this is really something totally new. We are entering into new, quite often uncharted territories. So this would be Karel, this would be my initial remarks, and clearly I would be more than willing to respond to any question colleagues may have. I deliberately refrain from commenting on eventual impact on either EU or the US or the Czech economy. And I have rather had respect for what has been presented. We know that we have a very good paper which sheds more light on impacts on the EU. I had the opportunity to look at the impact study prepared by one of German institutes. UK has made a tremendous job in evaluating impact not only on the UK economy, but also on the others. But I think it's important what Mark was saying in terms that it will not have, hopefully, and I am convinced of positive impact on bilateral relations between the EU and the US. It will have also tremendous impact on our partners, on our relations with third countries. And I will even go further to say that it will also change traditional trade flows between and among EU member states. So this will be my initial remarks, and thank you very much for this opportunity, and definitely I'll be more than willing to come back later and comment on some specific issues. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dan. The next speaker is Martin Tlapa. We are many years cooperating with Martin Tlapa at the level of small and medium enterprises. Martin, I'm a small and medium entrepreneur. We have a really different troubles than the TTIP. How can you persuade me, how can you persuade us that the TTIP will have the impacts to our activity?
Thank you. So, once again, I'm now in my shoes, so it's better for me to talk on behalf of myself about the topic. So, thank you very much for the invitation. And before I do, remember my congratulations to Vilém for his presentation on policy paper. I think it was a great paper, and it's always good to have some figures and evidence, even if it's difficult to make any prediction about the deal. But I think it's a great paper, and it seems to be good to look to be deep on that and study. Generally, the challenge with all the papers and expectation about the deal is that we are considering the past and prolong and make a trend for the future. So, but personally, I hope that the deal will bring the new opportunities, and it will lead also to change the structure of the trade, and we will succeed together in the global economy together. As Elena has mentioned, is I would say a very short speech.
This time.
I think what is challenging for us is to succeed in global chains and global economy, and definitely leads to having a focus on that. I'm trying to answer the question. First, you know, this deal is about the information for SMEs. Something is happening. Let's look on that, because the governments and EU and US decided to talk about the deal. So what we can expect is counter tariffs. It's no big issue, but it is a signal that some regulation barriers, which are essential, are huge, are important for business, they'll hopefully fall down and will be eliminated in the future. So that's a signal for SMEs. Hey, look on that, because it's an important message for companies in the global economy. The second point, I hope that in discussion we will be also more open to discuss about about current trade disputes, and it would be a great signal for both sides, US and EU, to try to eliminate the number of trade disputes we are facing right now. And this is a good number, unfortunately, the trade disputes on both sides. So I think the part of the talks we will have in the future will be that the disputes will come down, because it's definitely very important. The most important thing, as I mentioned, is I think it's a great signal, because we discussed by Bryan, and I think it was not the best answer in the financial crisis and economic slowdown in the global economy. And in Europe, we're discussing what's happening in the US, and protectionism is there. So I think that to lift our barriers and come back to have a deal with the down barriers is a good signal. Unfortunately, I think it's partly because multilateral round has failed. And we need to think later this year about the future of this round. But in the meantime, I think it's good to have such ambition to come to the barriers in that. I don't think that we will succeed to make a deal in so ambitious deadline we set. It would be great, but if we will really try to lift our barriers in so sensitive sector regulations in financial services and other things, it will take time. I think it's better to focus on the great result and bring up the official time to have some kind of deal. So I hope that the quality and the coverage of the deal will be more important than just to have a deal. Of course, we do understand the political cycle in the US and also the political cycle in Europe, sometimes difficult. So we need to find out some, as Geneva people says, window opportunity for finally making the deal. But it will takes time. From my understanding, it's the best the best opportunity and the best message from economic side is we do understand what is happening in the global economy. We need to cut the barriers to succeed in the global challenge we are facing, both US and EU, in the global economics. And we are able to cut the cost of production, to cooperate better, to enhance investment on both sides, to succeed in the global economy. Politically, and it was always the argument on the Czech side for negotiation, it would be great to lift our borders among groups of countries and nations which have common rules. So it's a strong, my understanding, also a political message. We have a common history, common values, and it's important to lift our borders to sell the idea of freedom in trade, also the freedom also in trade. So this is an important also a political message and that decision to make a deal. I hope that there will be as less as possible exceptions from the deal. I think that the value of the deal will be if we will really keep the ambitions at the beginning, and we will try to exclude only a very, very limited number of issues which will be sent before us. So I understand, and we do understand the movie industry, how it is sensitive for some countries in Europe, but we really appreciate it still there's an open door for the future to discuss also this chapter, because the last exception the deal will have is better for the future. So. And even if you will need to have a compromise, so it's important. You know, foreign trade is not a zero-sum game. It's not a mercantilistic game, from our understanding in the Czech Republic, the Czech side. So we hope that we will also make a benefit for the huge competition. Sometimes painful, sometimes difficult for some sectors or companies in the Czech Republic or in other European countries, also in the US. But the more competitive we will be in the deal, and the pressure for changing our production to move to things with a higher value, the more we will be successful in the global economy. So I only think that in this such kind of deals, we need to think in long term. the elections, usually we will not build 7th of FTA. That's the opposite is true. But in the long term, it's the responsibility of politicians to cut down borders because the liberalization is bringing the fruits in long term perspective. Not in short terms, because there's a lot of sensitivity so several sectors. So for SMEs, it means for me, back to the question at the beginning, hey, something is happening in our relations, let's look what should be the result and effect of the deal in the sectors I'm operating, what would be a future opportunities in regulation and regulatory framework for me. And let's try to study the opportunities. You know that the US is fast moving market, there's a huge potential, and the more and more opportunities that global economy will arise from cooperation together on the global economy with that market. So I think it's a chance for many SMEs in the Czech Republic. By the way, if you look at the figure of our exports in the EU, you would be surprised that the percentage of any value in the Czech Republic and our exports to US is much more higher than in the similar exports to many other European countries. So it seems to me that maybe because of the transactional costs, the potential is huge because we are exporting the things which need to have a strong independent value based in the Czech Republic or generally in European economy. That's the opportunity for the Czech Republic and Czech companies. But I'll be looking on that as an important message, and I hope in the meantime that both political and economic will be able to agree on many things. And if you will agree that this deal is helping us to agree on the common regulation, and we could be able to orchestrate the message from US and EU visit Asia, I think we will have a chance also in a regulatory framework to have a better voice. And this is important for the future of many sectors. So that's the beginning of the remarks. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you, your guests. Thank the speakers. Thank my friends. But thanks for the positive words. But for every winner, there are the losers. Let's discuss about the losers. What about BRICS? I visited a few weeks some BRICS conference, and the representatives of the BRICS, they are forecasting that in the next 5 years, the BRICS countries will be generate more than 65% of the GDP. Now, I see that the consequence of the TTIP will be that the European Union and the United States of America together, they will generate 50% of GDP. The skew is at 115%. What about the rest of the world? That's the maths is a beautiful discipline. So, Elena, TTIP, isn't it a barrier against the growing influence of BRICS?
I'm always amazed when I'm asked the question, isn't this agreement against somebody else? And how is it the US and the EU can do something together? Which I think is kind of a crazy question. We're looking to enhance our growth in jobs, but that's not to the exclusion of any other players in the world economy. Indeed, if we can make some progress on the regulatory cycle, for years I've had countries say to me, it's very frustrating because we're stuck between the US and the EU who have different standards, and we have to comply with both if we want to ship to your markets. If we can make some progress on the regulatory side, that actually should help countries that are standards takers and are flowing to both of our markets. This is a pro-transatlantic trade agreement, not an anti-trade with anyone else.
Well, thanks. Mark, I have a next question. To implement the TTIP into the United States of America, I see as a notable problem because there are 50 states which are respecting the uniform rules. But in the European Union, we have 27 different countries, which are speaking by 24 different languages. We are solving quite big particular problems, and don't forget that we have troubles like a European angry business, governmental societies, and many of the territorial benefits. How do you see this problem?
It's hard to make a general intelligence statement on that. First of all, I mean, it's true that we are more heterogeneous than the US, but might be. In quite a few areas we're going to discuss, the US is not homogeneous. Take public procurement. One of the big questions would be, will Washington be able to deliver the states? In GPA, which is the WTO set up for government procurement, to my recollection, there are only 9 US states that have signed up. 37? Okay, but anyway, the degree to which they have signed up is quite different. Now, we'll see what can be done on public procurement on the side of the states. There are a number of sectors that are regulated in the US at state level. Insurance is the example that comes to mind directly. But it's true that we are all heterogeneous. On the other hand, fortunately, there's such a thing like the primacy of EU law compared to national law. If something has been agreed upon at EU level, it has to be implemented at the national level of the member states. But it is an issue. One of the problems we have when we negotiate with third countries is that we don't have yet a single market for services. Often a partner tells us, hey, wait a moment, we're not negotiating with one, but with 27. The fact that on a number of things we don't have a single market handicaps us very much in our discussions with third countries. But that's a fact of life, we have to cope with it. The fact that we have concluded with Korea, that we are very, very close to completing a free trade agreement with Canada, which by the way is also very decentralized, means that trading blocs can do deals despite the fact that many of its competences are not at the central.
Thanks. Milan, you are monitoring the Czech position from the point of view of relationships with USA as a global business. How do you feel how can improve the business of the Czech corporations and also SMEs with USA? And do you mean that the impacts on the growth of the GDP will be real also in the Czech Republic?
Thank you very much for this question. I tell you, first we have to test each other's readiness, really, to engage. And I mean, I believe Mr. Semerák pointed to something what happened in the past. But I tell you, please, I don't want to be misunderstood. Transatlantic Council is fine in political terms. It has helped a lot to generate better or common understanding of many issues we are talking about. But if you really want to get a meaningful result, the only way to do that is to enter into full-fledged negotiation. And this is something that will only have the potential to see to what extent our words are up to our readiness to take certain specific actions. For example, many talked about government procurement. Clearly, we Europeans, we do have a quite important defensive interest in this particular sector, particularly if it comes to public utilities. But at the same time, we are quite bold in our offensive interests. Mark just mentioned whether the US will deliver on its ability to implement war at the federal and sub-federal level. And this is clearly one of the key issues. And any computation, any model we use now is based on the past performance, on the past trade. But because of those barriers, we have areas where there is no trade because simply you can't enter the market, or it's difficult to do that. Give you an example. Transport equipment. We do have a couple of companies that have proved their ability to execute that as well. They have been even successful in some of the US states. But any time they show interest in taking part in public tendering procedures, they have to deal with local content requirements. They have to find a partner. US partner. Otherwise, it would be extremely difficult to comply with existing requirements. I'm not saying that it is not doable. It can be done. But if we are able really to join our efforts, I mean, Americans and Europeans, we will be facilitating our respective businesses' lives. And it will have immediate effect on the cost of our businesses. And this is also in response to your original questions about small and medium-sized enterprises. And I'll tell you, when preparing for the meeting we had last week in Brussels, we fine-tuned the mandate for the Czech delegation in order to reflect specific interests for small and medium-sized enterprises. And sorry, Elena, because I'm just trying to show an example. Agriculture products. Some tend to say, well, probably for us, it is not as important for some others. And that's a fair statement, given the share of agriculture in GDP in the Czech Republic. But this is not to say that we don't have certain high quality agriculture processed products. And you would be interested to sell them in the US, including skimmed milk, other dairy products. But today, it is extremely difficult because there is a small window of opportunity. Tariff quota with reasonable tariff. But above that quota, it's over prohibitive nature. And then again, you need to find a partner. So these are concrete examples to bring people on board, to tell them what will happen if we are successful. Because it's about red tape. And if you cut that red tape in a way that we will not, and I think of Elena and Mark pointed to the direction, in a way that we are not questioning either US or Europe right to take care about certain safety reasons. If we are not, or we will not be questioning each other's right to regulate in environment protection area. But the example of
aviation industry. I like it very much. Another question is, well, the car being produced here in Europe, would it be difficult to imagine the situation when it will be recognized that if that car being produced in Europe does comply with technical requirements imposed by the EU, would it be recognized by the US? Because the objective of both of us is similar. We want to have something that is safe, and we want to have something that is environmentally friendly. Another question is to find a modus vivendi, to find a mechanism to recognize, harmonize tests that are being implemented on the other side of the Atlantic. And then, and final also, for being slightly late, we have been able really to create a team which consists of both government institutions, business representations, representatives of civil society, trade unions, and we intend to keep them informed on a regular basis about what is going on. But my understanding is that it is not just information sharing process. We have, as Mark, not only we member states, but the Commission has to be sufficiently reflective in taking businesses and representatives of civil society views into account while carrying out negotiations with the US. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Martin, I have last questions. I have two questions, macro question and micro question. One of the virtues of the European Union, and this is America, is that we can expect new jobs. So my question is, it's very clear, how many new jobs we can calculate in the Czech Republic? It's in 1,000, 100, 10,000, I don't know. And the second question is a micro question. What kind of the non-tariff barriers from the point of view of business? Non-tariff barriers will eliminate.
Thank you. I don't like the distinction between macro and micro, so that's the point. It's difficult to find out that that you know we have some studies and that shows that something is that generally we will benefit because the costs will down, the tariffs will come down, and there will be new opportunities for the workers. So. That's the framework for any model which we are using. So I don't know exactly about, I think I mentioned something in the speech at the beginning, but if it will be 1,000 or whatever, but I think it's not necessary to pray now to say exact numbers. I think that generally it makes sense that if the barriers and tariffs are down, there is a new opportunity for the companies and this is the information to try to use that advantage, which is a new one. Yeah. So that's the general question. The general answer to your question, because no one knows exactly precisely what will be the delivery of the deal in jobs. The more important thing is, as we discussed in our presentation, we touched upon a point about the regulatory framework and non-tariff barriers. And this is really essential. Yeah. So if you can imagine that we will play hockey in the same playing field, and we can imagine how is it feasible to make a deal, to play hockey in the same size of the playing field, both in America and Europe and the EU. It will make the benefits, yeah. Hockey players will not complain coming from NHL that we have different size of the playing field and it will be better maybe and it takes a lot of money for everybody. So, but on the other side, you may see how it's difficult because these things are coming from the history and from the different way of in the past. So don't overestimate that.
by the companies, and I think the motor of regulatory framework changes will be the companies who are investing on both sides of the Atlantic, because they need to cut down the barriers to be successful on the markets. So if in the IBM or companies like Philip Morris, and Philip Morris is not the best example. Sorry, but the huge investors in this sector. So, Hani want to say something, Hani. So these companies definitely are saying, hey, we need to cut the barrier because to be successful globally, we don't, we can't spend the money in a different legislative steps on both sides. And the same is valid for the suppliers and the small and medium sized companies. So, also in medical industries and electricity accounting system, there's a huge number of things which can be improved. And if we'll teach to be ambitious, this will be great for the future of the companies. But at the same time, it's not only about opportunities, it's about the threats as well. And threat is good on that way, because the more competition from both sides coming to Europe is a pressure to be successful and to change. If you look on the microeconomy publications about the competitive advantage, the story now is saying we need to, it's no more about stability. It's no more about long-term advantages we have in the business. It's more about temporary advantage that we can have in this turbulency time and chaos of everything. So we need to understand what's happening and keep at least our temporary advantage. Because the life and business world is changing so quickly. So this is a good impulse for using new opportunities on both sides to make pressure to change, to be better, to find new partners and suppliers on both sides to succeed in the global economy. So I think this is one of the most important features of the deal we are discussing today. And once again, the more we will be able to orchestrate the regulatory framework for the world, and this is a real danger. We will fail to break competition, that everybody will be dictated from the countries outside, and it's costly to companies to adjust all the things according to the rules which are developed outside. So I think if we will be able to manage these things successfully and orchestrate this regulatory framework from both sides of Atlantic together, the better will be our savings and opportunities to succeed in the global economy. So this is for me also a very essential and important part of the deal that we are discussing today.
Thank you. So we are managing the panel on the time. So our guests and their speakers, thank you very much. Elena, thank you. Mark, thank you very much. Elena, thank you very much. Martin, thank you very much. It was an excellent presentation. Thank you also to the audience. I don't know if we answered how to reach the Atlantic. I'm sure that it will be a long way, and I hope that it will be not bridged over troubled water. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are heading for the coffee break, which is taking place upstairs. We have 25-30 minutes for it. Thank you.